we're doing 3.8, it's the cell cycle. And it continues on from yesterday's lesson where we looked at the five stages of nuclear division, which starts with interphase, prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. So we're looking at the cell cycle in a bit, in a more holistic sense now. If we imagine that this is the time taken for a cell to undergo mitosis, then most of its time is spent in interphase. And we need to think of that stage as a stage where we don't actually know what's going on in the cell, because although DNA might be being copied, we don't know that until we get to prophase. The rest of the time when the cell is resting, it's also described as interphase. So it's not entirely correct when it says it's the resting stage, but it's also a little bit incorrect because it could actually be doubling its DNA, its nucleic acid. So we've got interphase, then we've got nuclear division, and then we've got cytokinesis. So the chapter starts talking about some cells that lose the ability to divide by mitosis. And it's not talking about stem cells in this case, it's talking about rather than one cell split into two, which splits into four, and so on, that sometimes the cells, once they've differentiated and divided, that's it. So some examples of that might be the germinal layer of your skin. So you've got a layer in your skin that continually divides by mitosis, but once it's divided by mitosis, those cells don't divide again. They just move through your skin layer. Likewise, your cardiac muscle. If you have a heart attack and you damage your cardiac muscle, you don't grow a new cells in your heart. And likewise, your neurons, your nerves in your brain, once you've got nerve damage, you don't grow more. So there are some cells that lose the ability to divide by mitosis once they've already divided. So what we're looking at today is how the cell may be triggered to divide. So if we think about it for a moment, you've got your surface area to volume ratio of a cell, and remembering that a small cell will have a larger surface area to volume ratio than a large cell. Yes, this one's got a larger surface area compared to that, but if we compare the surface area to volume ratio, and if you think about it in terms of a cube, it's much easier. If I've got a cube that measures 1 centimetre by 1 centimetre by 1 centimetre, its surface area is 6 centimetres squared, and its volume is 1 centimetre cubed. In other words, for every one piece of volume, there's 6 areas of surface area, which is great because it means that this one piece of volume can get as much oxygen, as much glucose as the cell needs. If we then increase the size, and let's just think about doubling it, and we've got our 2 centimetre by 2 centimetre cube, then straight away, my surface area becomes 24, and my volume becomes 8. Which gives me a ratio of 3 to 1, which means that it's only got 3 pieces of area serving 1 piece of volume. So as something gets bigger, its surface area to volume ratio decreases. So if we look at the graph in the book, it kind of shows us two things. It shows us cell growth, and then the cell divides. Cell growth, and then the cell divides. And then so this is the mass of our cell. And then what it does is it shows us how the mass of DNA changes. So if we look, it's on page 80, what we find is the mass of DNA might stay the same, then it increases, and then the cell divides. The mass stays the same, then it increases, and then it divides in line here. Now, the other thing that's interesting to notice is if this is the mass of DNA, that it's at this point here of its growth that the trigger has been sprung for the cell to then go into the DNA replication phase of interphase. When it got to here, that's the point there where the DNA started to increase. And then at this point here, and then at this point here, you can see where the division is. So it's at this point that the critical stage was reached where the cell's surface area was suddenly too small to supply the volume. So what we're looking at today is about cancer. And cancer is an uncontrolled growth of cells. So I want you to think about a cell as a car driving along the highway and it's got its accelerator permanently pressed to the ground. Its natural rhythm is to divide, 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 divide. And it's the brake that's slowing it down all the time. And that's the normal state of your cells. You've got a gene that is stopping your cells from dividing. What carcinogenic factors do, such as alcohol, x-rays, UV light, is they remove that gene or they stop that gene from working. So the stop signal goes and the cell goes into uncontrolled division. With that uncontrolled division, the cell changes in its structure. It no longer resembles, for example, a skin cell or a cell in your liver or whatever. It loses its structural components, which means that it loses its functionality as well. And we end up with a callus, a big mass of cells. Now, if you're unfortunate enough to get a tumor, you want it to be something called a benign tumor. Because benign tumours also make like a gluey type substance that sticks them together. They grow really slowly and often they're encapsulated so that they don't spread. Malignant tumours are much looser, they're not as dense, they're not encapsulated and bits can break off and travel around the body. So when they travel around the body, that's obviously where we have secondary cancers form and so on. And clearly we don't want that to happen. And that is the whole point of studying the cell cycle. Last lesson we learned about the different stages, interphase, prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. If we can learn one way to interfere with those various stages and stop the cell cycle from progressing, we can stop cancer. We can treat cancer. So currently, when we hear about chemical therapy, what happens is a chemical is given and the two target areas at the moment of the cell cycle is that it stops interphase. In other words, it stops the DNA from being replicated and copied, or the other one is that it during metaphase, it interrupts spindle formation. So if you remember in metaphase, we've got our centrioles, we've got our chromosomes lining up, and we have these spindles that grow down, attach onto the centromere, and then contract and pull the chromosomes to opposite poles of the cell. If we interfere with this formation, then that cell can't then split during cytokinesis to make two more cells. So this is a way that we are moving forward in the treatment of cancer. Now, just before we close on that, I just wanted to recap on the difference between a chromosome and a chromatid. Remember last lesson we talked about in the nucleus of a cell? You can't see the DNA because it's all unwound. It would be like looking at a ball of wool that was all unraveled from 200 meters high. You can't see it. However, what we did say was that as the DNA is copied, you still can't see it. But later on in interphase, the DNA gets twisted and it shortens and it thickens. And that's why we said that a chromosome, which might normally be unwound there, will be seen at this stage. We still call it a chromosome, even though it's being copied, and each half of the chromosome is now called a chromatid. And these are called sister chromatids. But the whole thing altogether is still a chromosome. So the other pair of that might look like this. So that would be one chromosome pair. And it's at prophase, following interphase, it's being copied already.